Welcome to another episode of Behind the Science Rockstar Edition. I'm your host, Jennifer Fournier. There is a worldwide debate going on about a very common pesticide called glyphosate. This debate is actually quite chilling because of the frequent use of this common pesticide. So in this episode of Behind the Science, knowledge is power. No matter the debate, we are here to answer the question, how can we accurately detect this common pesticide? Hi, Jeremy, how are you?
Good, how are you, Jane?
Actually, I'm quite concerned. I was reading an article that was stating that there was an overwhelming majority of a certain population that's contaminated by a chemical called glyphosate. Actually, in this article, it stated that 75% of this population was found to have this chemical in their urine. Is this something we need to be concerned with?
Yes, you're right, Jane. So glyphosate is one of the most common used pesticide, both in agricultural product and at home in your garden. But in terms of toxicity, there really are two camps. So one region may think it's a low to medium risk, but the other region, they disagree. They think it's highly toxic. They really should be regulated.
So does that mean that one region uses it more than another?
No, both regions use quite extensively. Just that how they want to regulate it might be different.
Okay, could you maybe show me some more information on this growing trend of using glyphosate?
Sure, let's go to the whiteboard.
Sounds good.
Let's take a look at the global usage of glyphosate. Here we see a graph on the left, which is the annual usage of per pound of glyphosate versus the years, starting from 1987 all the way to 2014. As you can see, the usage started very low, and in the middle, you're seeing a lot of genetic modified crops being introduced, and these amount of genetic modified crops are engineered so that they can resist glyphosate. Let's focus on the year 1994 and 2014. And here we can see a map of United States. And here on the left, we can see the usage at year 1994. And that was before the years genetic modified crops were introduced, which means they're used quite commonly. But when you see 2014, after several crops introduced, and really the usage of glyphosate exponentially grows.
Wow, so we're really using more and more of this pesticide. That just screams testing. Is there an easy way to analyze these?
Glyphosate really is an analytical challenging analyte.
What makes it so analytically challenging?
If you look at the structure, glyphosate is a very small and very polar compound. So secondly, it does not have any chromophore, so it cannot be detected by UV. And lastly, the current method is labeling glyphosate and analyzed by GCMS. And people really would like to analyze directly without using any labeling.
All right, so what could be our solution?
Oh, we recently found a good solution for it. By using our helix chromatography, using our porous DEA columns, and we can analyze these compounds without any issue.
Could you show me some more data?
Absolutely. Let me show you more details.
Great.
Here we show a typical chromatogram of glyphosate-related compounds, EMPA, glufosinate, and glyphosate. These are unlabeled analytes with excellent retention on the DEA column. By using Xevo TQXS mass spectrometers, this analysis is very reliable and sensitive.
Sounds like we found a good solution to a tough analytical problem.
Yes. Looks like we have some help back there.
I say take that polar pesticide.
Let's go.
There has to be a way to combat weeds without using so much herbicide. However, in the meantime, we have a great method that can accurately, with high sensitivity, detect even low levels of glyphosate. So take that, highly polar pesticide. For more information on how to tackle the tough polar pesticide problem, go to the link below for more information. And join us next time for another episode of Behind the Science Rockstar Edition.